بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يحده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. So regarding the subject, which is al-Iman, which is faith or belief, al-Iman, and how a Muslim, how a believer protects and safeguards his Iman, then we say, starting with the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which he's speaking to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابِ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا نَحْدِي بِهِ مَنْ نَشَاءَ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. Allah said to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you, meaning you, O Muhammad, you did not know what was the book, nor what was Iman. However, we made them, the book and Iman, to be a nur, to be a light, by which we guide whomever we will. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not know what was the book. The book was not revealed to him, nor did he know what was Iman. So Allah taught him Iman through that which was revealed to him. And likewise, Allah says regarding the believers, the believing men and the believing women, on the day of judgment, Allah says, يَوْمَ تَرَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَسْعَى نُورُهُمْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَبِأَيْمَانِهِمْ بُشْرَاكُمُ الْيَوْمَ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمِ. Allah says, on the day that you will see the believing men and the believing women, their light will be in front of them, rushing in front of them and to their right, and they will be given glad tidings that to you that on this day will be gardens beneath which rivers flow, and you will remain therein forever. And this is the greatest success. So in other words, this nur is their iman, the iman which they held and which they practiced in this life, and that will become a nur for them on the day of judgment. And Allah says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. That Allah will establish those who believe, have this iman, with a firm speech in this life and in the hereafter. And the scholars explain that what is meant here is that when a person is asked in the grave the three questions, who is your Lord, and what is your religion, and who is this man who was sent amongst you, that this is what this verse is referring to, that Allah, those who believe, have iman, that Allah will make them firm, give them a firm statement in this life and the hereafter. And likewise, so this iman that we are speaking of in these verses, this iman is the same iman on account of which the believers, when they pass across the bridge over the hellfire, there will be some amongst them who, on account of their iman, will pass it like the flash of lightning. Like the flash of lightning, because of the iman. And there will be some amongst them who will pass it in the blink of an eye. And there will be some amongst them who will pass it like a swift wind. And there will be some amongst them who will pass it like a speedy rider on horseback, who rides with speed on his horseback. There will be some who will pass it running. And there will be some who will pass it walking swiftly. There will be some who will pass it walking. There will be some who will pass it crawling. And there will be some who will pass it, and they will be snatched and thrown into the hellfire. And all of that is based upon what? This iman that Allah taught the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the book and in the sunnah. And likewise, A person who enters the hellfire, so when he passes over the bridge and he is from those people who will be snatched and he will fall into the hellfire, then by on account of the iman that he still has, he will be removed from the hellfire because of the iman which he possesses. Like the messenger said, that there will be removed from the hellfire anyone who has even the smallest seed or the atom's weight of iman in his heart. So this is the iman. These are some of the virtues and the greatness and the excellence of this iman. And it is only when we understand, and this is only a small selection of the verses, and only a small select because we don't have the time to go through everything, but there is much, much more in the Quran and in the Sunnah which teaches us and which informs us the greatness of this iman. So when a believer understands that this is the effect and this is the result of this iman which Allah has bestowed upon him, which Allah has favored him with, like Allah says in the Quran regarding a group of people, Allah says, يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا قُلْ لَا تَمُنُّوا عَلَىٰ إِسْلَامِكُمْ بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ مَنْ حَدَاكُمْ لِلْإِيمَانِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. There was a group of people who came to the Prophet ﷺ, and they came and they made it look as if we accept Islam, we are doing you a favor. It's as if we are doing you a favor for accepting Islam. And Allah said to them, Don't treat your Islam as a favor. Rather, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has given you the favor in that He has guided you to iman if you are really truthful. So this iman is a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, when the believers have entered paradise, when they eventually enter paradise, this is what they will say. Allah says that the believers will say, الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله لقد جاءت رسل ربنا بالحق. So they will say, so once they've entered paradise, they will say, all praise is due to Allah who guided us to this, and we would never have been guided to this had not Allah guided us to this. And indeed, messengers came to us with the truth. So this iman, from this selection of verses which you've heard, which are by no means exhaustive, it's only a small selection, you now understand that a believer, that a Muslim and a believer should be eager for this iman. Now that you know the weightiness of this iman, imagine yourself, you will either be crawling on that bridge, or you'll be snatched on that bridge, or you'll be walking swiftly on that bridge. All of this is in accordance with your iman and what your iman produces from the righteous actions. So therefore, once we understand that this is the worth and the value and the greatness of this iman, it is essential for every Muslim, for every believer, to understand exactly what is that iman that has come in the book and the sunnah. What is this iman? What is this definition? What is its reality? Because if we don't understand this, then believe me, you will have mistakes and deviations and shortcomings in your belief and likewise in your action. So therefore, we need to now clarify what is this iman that is defined in the book and the sunnah and which is explained by the companions and the scholars of the righteous salaf, so that we are upon clarity, that we are upon basira, insight. So with respect to this, some of the Salaf have said that this iman isn't something by which you beautify yourself on the outside, nor is it something that you just crave for and you make wishes, that you have wishes and desires and that's all it is. This is not iman. Iman is something that comes into your heart, it settles into your heart, and then your actions bear witness to the truthfulness of what is in your heart. This is iman. Iman, something that enters into your heart, then your actions bear witness to the truthfulness of what is in your heart. So the actions are a sign of the truthfulness as to that which is in your heart. So iman, therefore, As the scholars have defined, iman consists of three things. As they say, al-iman qawlun wa i'tiqadun wa amalun. This is how the Salaf, they summarized the belief of a Muslim with respect to iman, that we believe that iman is speech. Iman is something that takes place on your tongue. And likewise, iman is something which is belief. The beliefs which you hold in your heart are from iman. And likewise, iman is something that you act with your limbs. Right? These three things, iman takes place in all of these three things. It is in your heart, it is upon your tongue, and it is upon your limbs. And these three things must come together in order for iman to be present in you. They must come together. So any person who claimed or thought that iman is something that is just on the tongue, that a believer says, I believe in Allah and I believe in the Messenger, without looking at what is in the heart and without anything upon his limbs, then this is incorrect. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described this iman to be the iman of the munafiqeen, the iman of the hypocrites. Allah says regarding them, these are people who believed with their tongues, but they did not believe with their hearts. So Allah said regarding them, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. That amongst mankind are those people who say, we believe in Allah and the last day, but they do not truly believe. يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ. That they seek to deceive the Allah and those who believe, but they do not deceive except themselves. فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ. That in the heart is a disease, and Allah will increase them in their disease, and for them is a painful punishment on account of that which they used to, the lies that they used to tell. So this shows that iman, that a person who says, I believe in Allah and I believe in the Messenger, but he's lying in his heart, then this is not the iman that Allah has asked for in the Quran. This is not the iman. And likewise, iman isn't something which is in the heart only, as opposed to what is upon the tongue. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned about the kuffar, about those people who did not accept Islam in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said about them that these people, they knew that the Prophet is the Prophet of Allah. They knew that Allah sent him. They knew that Allah revealed the book upon him. And they knew that he is Al-Amin, As-Sadiq, Al-Amin. He is the truthful one. He is the trustworthy one. Yet at the same time, they did not believe in him. Even though their hearts knew it and were convinced of it, they did not express with their tongues, and they did not say, I testify that none has a right to be worshipped except Allah, and that Muhammad is the Messenger of Allah. And Allah said about these people, he said about them, فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ. That indeed these people, they do not reject you, but rather it is the signs and the verses of Allah that they reject, that these wrongdoers that they reject. So, in other words, these people, in their belief, they knew he was the Messenger, they knew Allah sent him, they knew the Quran is from Allah, but what prevented them from speaking with the Shahada? It was arrogance. So arrogance. So sometimes a man can know the truth, but his arrogance prevents him in acting by the truth. And likewise, these people, some of them were jealous. They were jealous and they did not accept the truth because prophethood came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like the Jews who were present. They came to Medina and they came to those places expecting that the Prophet would be from amongst them. But it turned out to be the Prophet alaihi wasallam was from the offspring of Ismail. And so they became jealous and they didn't accept the truth. So even though they knew, like they knew their own sons, that he was indeed the Prophet that was mentioned in their Torah, and likewise in the Injil, so they didn't accept it. They didn't accept him, even though they knew the truth. And likewise, some of them, they didn't accept Islam, even though they knew it, because of wealth, or because of status, or because of position. And all of this prevented them from saying, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. So what does this prove? This proves that Iman isn't something that is in the heart only. This is incorrect. And this is not the Iman that Allah has requested from us in the Quran and in the Sunnah. So this is not correct either, neither on the tongue only, nor in the heart only. And likewise, Iman is not just belief in the heart and speaking with the tongue. This is not the Iman in the book and the Sunnah. Rather, there must be action alongside these two things, as we mentioned previously. And this is why in the Quran we see that whenever Allah mentions belief, He always mentions action. This occurs many, many times in the Quran. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ يَحْدِيهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِإِيمَانِهِمْ. That indeed those who believe and do righteous actions. And how many times does this occur in the Quran? And likewise Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ نَعِيمٌ. That indeed those who believe and do righteous actions, they will have gardens of bliss. And likewise Allah says in another verse, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ نُزُلًا. That indeed those who believe and do righteous deeds, then they will have the gardens of Firdaus. The gardens of Firdaus as an abode. So all of this proves that Iman with Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'ah, with the people of the Sunnah, the people of the Jama'ah, the people who adhere to what the companions were upon and what the Imams of the Salaf were upon, is that they say and we say that Iman is belief, speech and action. So for example, when you believe that this Quran is the speech of Allah, that belief of yours is Iman. And when you believe in paradise and hellfire, that belief of yours is Iman. And when you believe in any specific thing which has come in the book and the Sunnah, like for example, that there will be houses made of pearls in paradise, or that there will be a certain type of food in paradise, or that a person will be punished in the grave on account of backbiting. Each one of those beliefs that you hold is Iman. And the place of that belief is in your heart. Likewise, when you feel the emotion of fear in your heart, when you fear and you fear Allah, that is Iman. And when you feel the emotion of love in your heart for Allah, that is Iman. And when you have tawakkul, when you place reliance in your heart, that tawakkul is Iman. When you have a hope in your heart, that you hope in Allah for something, that emotion that you feel is Iman. So we have a belief and actions in your heart. Likewise, when you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, this saying is Iman. And when you say Subhanallah, or Alhamdulillah, or Allahu Akbar, or any type of dhikr, that is Iman. And likewise, when you command somebody to do the good, you command him with good, or when you prohibit him from evil, when you say to him, do not drink, do not gamble, or when you say to him, you should pray the Nawafil prayers, when you order him with good, all of this is from Iman. And likewise, when you perform the Salah, when you perform the actions, and we perform the Hajj, and all the other actions, this likewise is with, all of this is Iman. So all of these things, if you imagine a circle, and the circle is Iman, then every one of these things that we've mentioned, they all come into Iman. And we need to understand this. Why? Because there are some people, and there are some sects and some groups who present Iman in a way other than it has come in the book and the Sunnah. So from these people are the ones who say that Iman is just to know Allah in the heart. If you have knowledge that Allah exists, know that He exists and He's your Lord, you are a believer. And this is false, because Iblis knew Allah. Fir'aun knew Allah. The Jews and the Christians know Allah. Even an atheist, in his knowledge and in his intellect, he knows that there must be a Lord, but his arrogance prevents him from acceptance. So anyone who said that iman is just to know Allah, this is a lie. This is a lie against the religion. It is a lie upon the Quran. It is a lie upon the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not the iman that the Book and the Sunnah have come with. Likewise, some people say, and this the people who say this one, this particular belief, are the Jahmiyyah, the followers of Jahm bin Safwan. And likewise, there are other people who say that iman is just to accept the truthfulness that the Messenger is true, to accept the belief that the Messenger is the Messenger, that the Quran is from Allah, that Allah exists, right? To make tasdeeq. And these are the Ash'aris, the Ash'a'ira, the people who call themselves the Ash'a'ira. They say they give iman a linguistic definition. And we know that the realities of the Sharia, they don't depend just upon linguistic definitions. Rather, they depend upon the Book and the Sunnah, the meanings of the Book and the Sunnah. So these people, they take the linguistic meanings of words and say that iman just means, in the language, tasdeeq, meaning to believe and accept something as true. So therefore, iman is just tasdeeq. And therefore, actions are not from iman, speech is not from iman, and all of this is not the iman in the Book and the Sunnah. And they're the Ash'aris. And then there are some other people, they say that iman is something you say just with your tongue. Like the Karramiyyah, this is a sect called the Karramiyyah. They say that a person who says with his tongue, I believe in Allah, I believe in the Messenger, he is a believer. And this is false, because we know in the Quran, Allah declared the hypocrites to be liars. Even though they were saying with their tongues, we know that you, O Muhammad, are the Messenger. Well, they accepted these things. So this is incorrect. And likewise, there are some people who say that iman is in your heart and in your tongue when you say the shahada, but as for the actions, they are not from iman. Again, this is incorrect. All of this opposes the Book and the Sunnah. And the reason why we need to understand this is because if you don't hold a correct belief with respect to your iman, like if you believe that iman is just in your heart and iman is just on your tongue, then you won't care about your actions. You will fall into sins. You will abandon those things which are wajib. You will take action lightly, and therefore you will be losing that iman. You will be damaging that iman. You will be destroying that iman, on account of which you will be entered into paradise. On account of which you will potentially go over the bridge like lightning, or like the blink of an eye, or like a speedy horse ride, or whatever. This is what you will fall into. On top of this, we say that iman increases with actions of obedience, and it decreases with actions of disobedience. If you do righteous deeds, your iman will have increased. If you do evil deeds, your iman will have decreased. So therefore, from our belief, so on top of what we've mentioned, iman is belief, and it is speech, and it is action. Iman takes place in your heart, it is upon your tongue, it is upon your limbs. On top of this, we also believe that iman increases and it decreases. It will increase, like some of the Salaf said, a person's iman will increase until it becomes like the mountains. And it will decrease up until nothing remains from it. Nothing is left from it. And the proof for this, there are many proofs for this. And one of the proofs is that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ra'a minkum munkaran that whoever amongst you sees an evil, فَلْيُغَيِّرُهُ بِيَدِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِئْ فَبِلِسَانِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِئْ فَبِقَلْبِهِ وَذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. That whoever amongst you sees an evil, then let him change it with his hand, if he's able. If he can't change it with his hand, then to change it with his tongue. And if he can't change it with his tongue, then with his heart, meaning let him hate it with his heart. And that is the weakest of iman. And this hadith proves that believers have different levels and ranks with respect to the iman. Some people's iman is so weak that if they see an evil, they're not able to speak about it or change it. Other people's iman is a bit stronger in that when they see an evil, they will speak about it. And other people's iman is stronger in that they will try to change it with their hand, obviously within the domain in which they have the right to change it with their hands, like in their family and their children or whatever. So this hadith proves that iman varies amongst the people. Another proof, وَيَزِيدُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ اَحْتَدَوْ هُدَى. Allah says in the Quran that Allah will increase those who seek guidance in guidance. This is a proof that their iman increases. And another verse Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذَا مَا أُنزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ أَيُّكُمْ زَادَتْهُ هَذِهِ إِيمَانًا فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَهُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. Allah says that every time a surah is revealed and sent down, then some the people say, which of you has had his iman increased? And they say, and as for those who believe, then it has increased them in iman, and they rejoice. And this proves that every time Allah revealed a surah from the Quran, the surah contained knowledge. The believers, they took this knowledge, they looked at this knowledge and what it contains of ilm, of knowledge, of belief, and of action, and they acted upon it. And all of this is an increase in their iman. So their iman increased more than what it used to be before this surah was revealed. So therefore we believe regarding our iman, that iman increases and decreases. So we have two things now. Iman is belief, speech and action. It is in the heart, upon the tongue, it's upon the limbs. And on top of that, it increases with obedience and it decreases with disobedience. And on top of this, we believe that iman, the foundation of iman, is six pillars. Iman has six arkan, the six pillars. And this is in the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam, which we are all familiar with. When he came and he asked him about Islam, what is Islam? Then he said, what is iman? And the messenger said, iman is that you believe in Allah and in his angels and in his books and in his messengers and in the last day and in al-qadr, the divine decree, it's good and it's evil. So the faith of a Muslim, the foundation and the pillar, just like a building has pillars and foundations, then the pillar of a Muslim's belief is these six aspects of belief. So a Muslim learns belief in Allah. He learns belief in the angels and the books and the messengers. And this is the foundation of his iman. From this knowledge, when he acquires this knowledge in his heart, then the emotions start to appear. Love appears in his heart, and fear appears in his heart, and hope appears in his heart. And when these emotions, when this knowledge produces these emotions in his heart, then his heart leads to action on the outside. So the love and the fear and the hope that this knowledge produces in him, it then leads to actions on the outside. So this is the foundation of iman, the six pillars. If anyone rejects any one of these pillars, he is a kafir. He has no iman. If you deny, if you reject belief in Jibreel alayhi salam, you have no iman. If you reject belief that Allah sent books, amongst which was the Torah and the Injil and the Zabur, then you have no iman. If you reject belief in a messenger from amongst the messengers, so if you believe in Isa and Muhammad and Ibrahim, but you say, I don't believe in Yahya or Nuh alayhi salam, then you are a kafir and you have no iman. If you believe in all of the Quran, but you say, this verse I cannot accept, you are a kafir and you have no iman. So these are the foundations of iman. And then on top of this, so now we have iman is belief, speech and action. It increases with obedience. It decreases with disobedience. It has six pillars. And on top of that, it also has branches. Iman has branches. And these branches, they complete iman. So the six pillars that you have, they complete that iman. And this is mentioned in the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-imanu bid'un wa sab'una shu'batan aw bid'un wa sittuna shu'batan afdaluha qawlu la ilaha illallah wa adnaha imatatul adha an at-tariq wal haya'u shub'atun min al-iman. In this hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, iman has 70 odd branches, or 60 odd branches, or 60 odd branches, and the greatest of them, or the most virtuous of them, is the saying La ilaha illallah, and the lowest of them is to remove something harmful from the floor. And modesty, al haya, is a branch from the branches of iman. This hadith, the scholars have used this hadith to prove a number of things. First of all, this hadith is a proof to show that iman is belief, speech and action. The proof is that the messenger said that iman has 70 odd branches. The highest of them is to say La ilaha illallah, or to testify La ilaha illallah. This is something that you do with the tongue. This proves that iman is something on the tongue. But at the same time, when you testify to something, when you bear witness, you are witnessing to something with your tongue, because you believe that is the truth in your heart. So this hadith at the same time is a proof that iman is something in the heart as well. On top of that, the messenger said that the lowest of them is to remove something harmful from the floor, which is an action. So actions are from iman. And likewise he said, modesty or al-haya is from iman. And haya is an action of the heart. So this hadith, the scholars have used this hadith to prove that iman is the belief of your heart, it is the actions of the heart, it is the saying with the tongue, and it is the action with the limb. So this proves that iman has branches, and these branches complete and perfect that which is the foundation, which are the six pillars of iman. Then on top of all of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that there are certain characteristics, the sifat, that the believers who have iman, that they should be displaying. This is a proof that you have iman. So what are these characteristics? These characteristics, Allah has mentioned them in the verses in the Quran, and from them Allah says regarding this, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلِيهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. Allah says, indeed those whom when Allah's name is mentioned, then their hearts tremble. And when the verses of Allah are recited upon them, it increases them in iman. And upon their Lord do they make tawakkul. So they have tawakkul upon Allah. And then he continues, those who establish the prayer. So they establish the prayer. And they spend, meaning in charity, from that which we have provided them. And these are some of the main characteristics. That they establish the prayer, they have tawakkul upon Allah, and they spend in charity. And likewise, in the beginning of Surah Al-Mu'minun, the surah is called Al-Mu'minun, the believers who have faith. Allah mentions many characteristics at the beginning of this surah. The first 10-15 verses. From them Allah says, indeed the believers will be successful. Those who have khashya in their prayer. And when they pray, they are humble. This is a sign of your iman, that you are humble. Your heart is not in another valley. Rather it is concentrating, fearing Allah, reflecting upon what it is saying, bringing to mind that Allah is watching him. Allah is in front of him. This is the believer. He has khashya in his prayer. And those who turn away from false speech, vain speech, useless speech, the believer does not fall into vain, false, useless speech. And those who give zakah, and those who preserve and protect their private parts, meaning from committing illegal intercourse, except with those who are their wives or that which their right hands possess. And likewise, Allah continues, those who are truthful over their trusts and covenants, that when they make a covenant or when they make an agreement, that they preserve and maintain those trusts and covenants. And likewise, those who guard and protect their prayers, they are the ones who will inherit, and they are the ones who will الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. They are the ones who will have firdaus, and they will remain therein forever. Look at all these qualities and characteristics of a believer. Likewise, Allah says, indeed, إِنَّمَا يَأْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Indeed, those who frequent the mosques, they come frequently to the mosques, they are only those who believe in Allah and the last day, they establish the prayer and they give the zakah, and they do not fear anyone except Allah. So these are some more of the characteristics of a believer. And what is meant here by the mosques, visiting the mosques and beautifying the mosques, isn't that you put decorations and things on the mosques, rather it means that you beautify them with dhikr, with knowledge, with remembrance, with worship, with reading the Quran, and with the nafal prayers, and with the obligatory prayers. This is what is meant. So from the characteristic of a believer who has iman, is that he visits the mosque to beautify the mosque. Not beautifying it with these decorations that we see, but with iman, righteous actions, with dhikr, with teaching, with forgiveness, with ibadah, with nafal, with reading the Quran. This is from the characteristic of a believer. So, and there are many other verses which establish. So now, what do we have? We have, first of all, Iman is belief, speech and action. Secondly, Iman increases and it decreases. Thirdly, Iman has pillars. There are six pillars of Iman. That is the base and the foundation. Fourthly, that Iman has branches. 60 or 70 odd branches which complete and perfect. Make a person's Iman complete and perfect. And this is what we believe with respect to Iman. Then after this, we should understand, my dear brothers and sisters, that Iman, a person's Iman, can be nullified. It can be invalidated. A person can become a kafir after being a believer. And this is what we call the nawaqidul Iman, or the nawaqidul Islam. When a person, he invalidates his Iman by actions or beliefs or statements. And from them we will mention very quickly, because we don't have much time, so I'm going to try and quickly go through whatever's left as quickly as possible, because inshallah the next speaker will start soon. So very quickly, just to mention one thing, is that in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a group of people who went along with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, making jihad with him, and they started making some statements about the companions of Allah's Messenger. They started saying, these people, you know, they've got big bellies and this very cowardly. And they just made this remark. And the reason why they said this was because they were traveling. And just to take away the weariness of travel, they thought they'd just make some speech like this. And so they spoke about the companions in this manner. They've got big bellies and they're so greedy and they're very cowardly when it comes to fighting. Just to take away the boredom of traveling. Now these people, Allah revealed a verse about them. Allah said about these people, Allah declared them to be disbelievers. Those who mock in Allah and His messengers, Allah revealed a verse in Surah Tawbah. And Allah said about them, لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. That do not seek to make excuses, for you have already disbelieved after your Iman. So this shows, and there are many, many things that can nullify a person's Islam, but this one in particular, because sometimes we can speak and we might joke, we might laugh, we might make fun, or we might think that this is light speech, and we don't realize that on account of it a person will invalidate his Iman, mocking anything from the religion, speaking lightly about anything from the religion. And the Messenger said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَتَكَلَّمُ بِالْكَلِمَةِ مِنْ سَخَطِ اللَّهِ لَا يُلْقِي لَهَا بَالًا يَحْوِي بِهَا فِي جَهَنَّمُ. That indeed a servant, he speaks with a word which angers Allah and he doesn't care, he doesn't really think too much of it, but this word throws him into the hellfire. Right? So we do not take this affair lightly, my dear brothers and sisters, that joking and mocking and making fun or speaking out of jest about anything from the religion is something that can take you outside the fold of Islam. And then inshallah, just to finish, because we don't really have time left, I'm going to give just maybe 8-9 things which we can use to protect our Iman and to preserve our Iman. So from them is, we should abandon all of the sins, the major sins and the minor sins, and especially the minor sins. As for the major sin, then a major sin, the Messenger said in the hadith that when a person commits fornication, he is not a believer. When he steals, he's not a believer. And when he drinks, he's not a believer. In other words, when he commits a major sin, then in that state, his Iman is the deficient Iman. He's gone away from being a believer to a fasik, to a sinner. And likewise, regarding sins, the small sins, the Messenger gave an example. He said, beware of the small sins. Because the small sins are like a group of people. They come to a valley, and then so one of them goes to collect some firewood, another one goes and collects some more firewood, another one goes and collects some more firewood. So each of them bring small twigs. They bring them all together, and what happens? They become huge. This is the nature of small sins. The small sins, you think they will not harm you and damage you, but when you add them all together, they can become like the mountains and lead to your destruction. So fear Allah with respect to the major sins and the minor sins. Likewise, to increase your Iman, protect your Iman, turn to the Book of Allah, memorize the Book of Allah, recite the Book of Allah, learn the Book of Allah, and reflect upon the Book of Allah. Because in this, there is an increase in your Iman. And likewise, do not feel secure from the plot of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, أَفَأَمِنُوا مَكْرَ اللَّهِ فَلَا يَأْمَنُ مَكْرَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Allah says, do they feel secure from the plot of Allah? Indeed, only those feel secure from the plot of Allah who are the losers. And regarding this, we see that the way of the companions and the way of the Salaf, they used to do good deeds, and at the same time, they used to fear that these good deeds would not be accepted from them. Right? They never felt secure and felt comfortable thinking, I'm a believer, I know my six pillars, I believe in Allah the Messenger, I'm secure and I'm safe now. You know, I won't fall into kufr, I won't fall into shirk, I can take it. They never thought like this. Rather, even when doing a good deed, like giving charity, they were giving charity whilst their hearts were fearful that this would not be accepted from them. So this is the way of the believer. When a believer thinks that he's doing good deeds, and he thinks Allah will accept this from him, by guarantee, automatically, this person is like the one that is mentioned in this verse. Only such a person who thinks like this is the one who is a loser. So when you think like that, then you are in a very dangerous situation. وَالْإِيَاذَ بِاللَّهِ. And likewise, from the things that will protect your iman is to have sabr, to have patience upon the acts of obedience, to have patience by keeping away from the acts of disobedience. This sabr helps to protect your iman. Allah says, Allah's Messenger said, no one has been given a gift better and more vast than patience. Patience, whoever has patience, he has been given the greatest of gifts and virtues. Likewise, from the things which give protect your iman is abundance, remembrance, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After the prayers, when you're sitting, when you're lying, when you're standing, to make dhikr with whatever has come in the book and the sunnah. Allah says, Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. That indeed by the remembrance of Allah do the hearts find satisfaction in their iman. And likewise from the affairs is to abandon oppression. Abandon oppression because this damages your iman. And oppression, you oppress yourself by committing sins and disobedience. This is oppression against yourself. So beware of that. You commit oppression against your families and your children by not giving them their rights. And you oppress other people by taking away their rights. So abandon oppression in all of its forms and all of its types. Also, to protect your iman, be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make shukr. Be grateful in times of ease and likewise in times of difficulty. Allah says, Allah's Messenger said, how amazing is the affair of a believer. All of his affair is good. And this is not the case for anyone except a believer. If some goodness comes to him, he is grateful, and this therefore is a source of good to him. If something harmful comes to him, then likewise that too is a source of goodness for him. Meaning, in everything which happens to a believer, he shows patience and he is grateful. And by showing this gratefulness and this patience, then he maintains and preserves his iman. And likewise, finally we finish with loving and hating for the sake of Allah. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من أحب لله وأبغض لله وأعطى لله ومنع لله فقد استكمل الإيمان. That whoever loved for the sake of Allah, he made his love for the sake of Allah, and who hated for the sake of Allah, who gave for the sake of Allah, and who withheld for the sake of Allah, then this one has completed his iman. He's completed his iman. And this is from the greatest of the handholds of Islam. When a person reaches this level, that he loves and hates for the sake of Allah, this is from the strongest of the bonds that tie him to him and to Islam and Iman and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finally, to finish then, inshallah, we will finish with just describing, quoting from Ibn Battah, one of the scholars who died in the year 387 Hijrah, and he said, and he is describing the way of the Salaf, the way of the companions, the way of the tabi'een. So he said, know, may Allah have mercy upon you, that it is from the affair of the believers and from their characteristics that iman is found with them. That we are people who have iman. That we have iman in our hearts, we have iman upon our tongues, we have iman in our actions, the righteous deeds. That this is what we are believers, we have iman upon us. And they are in constant fear for their iman. So this iman, having this iman, they are in constant fear about this iman. And they are severely cautious about their actions. Their hearts are in awe of the fear of losing this iman. And this is how the Salaf were. That even though they had iman, constantly their hearts were in fear and were in awe of losing this iman and having this iman taken from them. This awe has encompassed them. This iman has, this fear has surrounded them and encompassed them. They do not know what Allah will do with them for the remainder of their lives. And so they are cautious of self-praise. They don't praise themselves. They don't say we are believers, meaning that we've completed iman and perfected iman. They don't say these likes of things. Rather, they say what Allah said in the Quran, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ اتَّقَى. Don't start praising and purifying yourself. Allah knows best who is the one who really truly fears Allah from amongst you. Don't make this self-praise and this false praise for yourself, thinking you are a believer, complete and perfect in your iman, that you've brought all of iman. Now don't say this, don't believe this. The Salaf will never like this. And then he says that they, the Salaf, they used to fear being overcome by the plot of Allah in dying upon an evil condition. And they do not know which condition they will be in the morning, nor what condition they will be in the evening. This is the level of their fear. Because Allah has mentioned them in the Quran, no soul knows what it will earn tomorrow, and no soul knows in which land it will die. This is why the Salaf used to fear that they don't know when it comes to the evening, when it comes to the morning, they don't know how they're going to wake up and what condition they will be. They might be upon kufr, they might be upon nifaq, they might be upon something else. And so the Salaf used to fear this because they did not know what was from the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah describes them, Allah says that those who give charity while their hearts are in awe, in that they will be returning to their Lord. And the Salaf explain this verse and they say that they used to give righteous deeds while being fearful of losing these deeds. Right, so this is the way of the Salaf. And inshallah, we conclude with this, a statement from Ibn Battah. And this really teaches us that even though we have iman, this should be our condition. This is how we should behave. This is how we should act. And this is how we should fear losing our iman, like the Salaf did in these verses. وَبِاللَّهِ تَوْفِيقُ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ. And I believe inshallah that the next speaker is due to start very soon. By the time he comes, just one quick announcement inshallah ta'ala, which is that in 2 weeks' time, on the 25th, 26th and 27th of December, there is the conference in Birmingham, in the city of Birmingham, at the Salafi Masjid in Wright Street in Birmingham. Inshallah ta'ala, there will be like telelinks with some of the scholars, likewise some of the speakers. So inshallah, if you can try to attend, it's on the 25th, 26th, 27th, in 2 weeks from now. Wa jazakum allahu khairan. Inshallah.